For days, the wind has been in the south. It shook and played in the moors and went dandering up the sleeping grampians. But it brought more heat than cold, and all the parks were fair parched, sucked dry. The red clay soil of Kinraddy, gaping open for the rain that never seemed coming. Some said the north that had rain enough, with a dee in spate, and bairns hooking stranded salmon down in the shallows. But that was up Aberdeen way, where I was born and lived for my first 16 years. We dwelled then on the croft of Cairn Dhu in Echt. My father was John Guthrie, and my mother Jean. I was their only daughter, and they called me Christine.
Christine? Chris, are you in by?
I'm in the kitchen, Mother.
What's this you're at now? Oh, do you never tire of all your schooling and reading, lass?
No, I like it fine. And Father says if I stick in at my lessons, I might come out to be a teacher myself.
I was very pleased when you won that bursary. You'd like to be a teacher, wouldn't you?
I'd like it real well.
Chris Quine, you spend how much time with your books when you could be out being happy. Your best days are now, Chris. When you're neither bairn nor woman, there's the countryside your own and you it.
But for all my reading and schooling, two Chris Guthrie's there were that fought for my heart and tormented me. You'd hate the land and the coarse speak of the folk one day, and the learning would be brave and fine. Then next day, you'd waken with peewits crying across the hills, deep and deep, crying in the heart of you, and the smell of the earth in your face. Almost you'd cry for that, the beauty of it, and the sweetness of the Scottish land and skies. And you wanted the Scots' words to tell it to your heart. Then the moment passed, and you became the English Chris again. Back to the English words, so sharp and clean and true. For a while, till they slid so smooth from your throat, you knew they could never say anything that was worth saying at all.
He's got a fine plump belly on him, eh,
Will? Aye, has that. Father rode him all the way from Aberdeen after he bought him.
What's he called?
Well, his name's Prince. But I'll not call him that. I'll call him Jehovah.
That's a grand name, Will.
Aye, I heard the minister used it in church one Sunday. I've been saving it up ever since. Eh? Get over Jehovah.
What was that you said, Will? I asked you what you called the horse.
Jehovah.
Mind my money. If I ever hear you again take your maker's name in vain, if I ever hear you use that word again, I'll lip you.
Now you mind that. I'll lip you like a lamb.
So Will hated Father. He was 16 years of age and near a man. But Father could still make him cry like a bairn. The twins were born soon after, and Mother had as awful a time as she'd always had.
She's in guy sore pain, Father. Is there no sign of the doctor?
He'll likely come in the evening.
Say bad we twins.
Aye, bad.
Been bad before, but never this bad.
Well, man, you wouldn't be told.
the doctor stayed the whole night. My brothers, Dodd and Alec, shivered and cried in their room till Father went up and scalped them right sore. They'd something to cry for then, but they didn't care. Then he came downstairs again, though he hadn't been in bed for 40 hours, and sat with his head in his hands.
God forgive me, the lust of the flesh, this miserable sinner. It's the bonny red hair ever that rouses me and tempts my soul to hell. Have you nothing better than to stand there like a gawk?
I came down to see to the towels.
Then see to them. And set the table. The doctor will be wanting his breakfast. Lay it through in the parlor there.
What'll I give him, Father?
Boil him an egg. Move, damn you. It's near morning outside. I daren't.
I'm guessing when you hear me.
I hear you. Damn to hell, I'm not dead.
Near 5, I think. Would you like something to eat, Walt?
I couldn't close my eyes up there for hearing Mother.
I had no sleep myself. None of us have.
It's as though she was being torn and torn in the teeth of beasts and couldn't throw it any longer.
Aye. That was the first being born. The other still to come.
Twins. She shouldn't be having one bairn, much less twins. She's too old for that, and Guthrie kens it.
Father?
Aye, Father, the old beast.
But, well, what's Father to do it?
Don't you know? Well, what's a bull to do with a calf, you fool?
Quiet.
What about this? Come to me. Pour me a basin full, but plenty of soap nearby.
Aye, Doctor.
Well, Chrissy, hear me.
Aye, she hears you, Doctor. Only she's feared.
She'll have a damn sight more to fear when she's having a beard of her own. Pour out the water quick.
The pile of the pair of you.
So that was the coming of the twins at Cairn Dhuibh. There'd been barely room for us all before that time, but when Mother spoke of it, Father wouldn't listen.
More room. What more room do we want than we have? You think we're gentry?
We're not gentry, but we're not dinks either. Though you might think it the way we're all living on top of one another. It was barely enough room before the twins came, but now there's 8 of us.
8? You've little to complain of. My own mother had 9 bairns all at home in a place not half this size, just a button bairn in Pittodrie.
We know how you lived in Pittodrie.
We managed fine.
And we must do the same.
Be thankful if you do as well. My father was just a ploughman, but he brought us up to be God-fearing and decent.
Aye, we must be that.
Aye, we must. And I'll tell you this. If just one of your bairns turns out half as good, your face need never redden with shame.
You might have some thought for Chris and Will. The lass is near full grown. She should have a room of her own. Cairn Dhuibh's not big enough for all of us.
That's a fell-good farm. You know, it took years of sweat and charming to get the hardness out of the land.
Aye. And the hardness has gone elsewhere. Times I think you love that land better than any of us, or your own soul even. If there's to be no more rooms, there's to be no more bairns. There shouldn't have been anyway. Four of our family was fine, now there's six.
Fine. We'll take what God in his mercy may send to us, woman. Now see you to that. I'm taking up the lease again.
Well, well. We're to bide on here, then.
We are that. So content yourself.
Wall fence five. Yeah, wall fence, wall and wall. What dumb to hell, woman? Wall.
Whoa,
there. You damn near had me in the ditch.
Will you kindly remove your cart? You're causing an obstruction.
How can I move it? With a poor beast half feared to death. And no wonder. You come around that corner there, spitting and barking like a tink dog with distemper.
Oh, boy. I said you're causing an obstruction, my man.
I am not your man, thank God. For if I was, I'd take a shovel and scrape the muck and paint off your face before giving it a damn good wash.
Take a note of his nameplate, you hear? Take a note of his nameplate.
Go on, my manny. Do as the dirt of the gentry tells you. It's Guthrie. John Guthrie. Mr. John Guthrie.
You haven't heard the last of this, Mr. Guthrie.
We're leaving, Cairn Dhu.
Aye. He was in a fair rage when he was told they weren't renewing the lease. Yon woman was a friend of the landlord's, a cousin or something. Still, it might teach Guthrie to keep a civil tongue in his head.
He'll be guy sore of having to leave.
Yeah, maybe, but he's got no choice now. Mother will be pleased, though.
Where'll we go?
Blaweary, it's called.
Blaweary?
Aye, St. Kinraddy, down on the How of the Mearns.
What's the house like, John?
Oh, it's a fine, brave house for a wee place. It has three stories and a good kitchen. And there's a fair stretch of garden down to the road.
A garden?
Aye, and there's beech trees growing in it. And the agent said the hedges in the summer grew as bonny wee honeysuckle as you ever saw.
Sounds a right fine place.
Aye. And if we can live in the smell of honeysuckle, we might farm the bit place with profit. It hasn't had a tenant for a year. And the park will need a fair amount of work. 56 acres of red clay. For by some moor that runs off to a lock at the top.
Kinraddy of the Mearns. It's guy far away. Well, there's no place like Aberdeen, or folks as fine as them that bide by the Don. But I think I'll like your Blaweary well enough. When do we move?
January, and it's an ill month to be moving.
Wild weather it was that January. And the night on the slug road was smoring with sleet when we crossed over into the mountains. The cattle bunched there, tails to the wind, refusing the sting of the sleet. South across the Uncouthy Hills was a world cold and unchancy.
Come and well! Keep the cattle moving!
John! John! We'd better loosen up at Port Lethen and not try the slug road this night!
What was that?
We'd better put up at Port Lethen.
Damn to hell, you think I'm made a cellar?
No, I don't. But if the carts get stuck again, we might all die of the night.
This is the worst bet. Once we're over it, Kinraddy's just ahead. Have you no sense, young lad? Keep them moving.
So that was our coming to Blaweary and Kinraddy of the Mearns. We slept late into the next morning, coming up cold and drizzly from the sea. All the darkness I heard that sea, a shoom shoom that moaned by the lonely cliffs. Not that John Guthrie listened to such sounds.
Well, Chris, get up!
How many times do you have to be shouted? There's work to be done and gear to be shifted. You should be sick with your shame at yourselves, lying there, stinking in your beds with the day half gone. You two, set that fire before I warm your backside for you. Go on, hurry up!
could a fair bad night for moving into Blaweary.
They had that, Che. I've never seen the like.
It hasn't been your old buyer much good either. God, Mrs. Monroe, this is an awful buyer you have. It must leak like a sieve at times.
It's good enough for the likes of us.
Oh, aye, as you say. Aye, it's good enough for poor folks like us.
And who's poor? Let me tell you this, Chase Strachan. We've never needed anybody to come to our help, though we don't boast and blow about it all over the countryside, like some I could mention.
Oh, I meant no offence, Mrs. Monroe. No offence of any kind.
Your own place is nothing to blow about.
Oh, no, no, I wouldn't say that. Peasy's Knapp's a fine wee farm. Aye, and your parts of a fine black loam, Che. Not red clay like the rest of Kinraddy's sits on.
Aye, it would be. But in a scanner, yeah, that you can't so much as change your shirt without some old-fashioned brute staring in it.
It doesn't bother me or Kirsty.
No, it's the smell that bothers your wife.
Oh, what's a bit of guff? If she'd come across some of the smells I did in South Africa, she'd never as much as notice them. Much less run moaning to the neighbours about them.
Well, she won't have so far to run now that the new folk have moved into Blaweary.
Have they?
Aye, Guthrie. John Guthrie, I'm told. Some creature from up north. I live a hard time of Blaweary. It's coarse land, but it's quite lonely up there in the brae.
You have spoken to him?
No yet, but Kirsty get up to see if Mrs. Guthrie needed any help.
Oh, likely they will. It's a true enough saying, out of the world and into Blaweary.
Who'd think a place could get into such a state in a 12-month with nobody living in it? It's right good of you to help, Mrs. Strachan.
It's no more than neighbourly. And my name's Kirsty. Che would have come with me, but he promised to stop by at Cuddiston to mend the roof of their byre. Oh, he's a handy billy, Che, if you want anything done. He'll live a calf, reckon a horse, kill a pig, all in a jiffy.
You mentioned the Cuddiston. Is that the place down by the crossroads?
Aye, the Monroe's farm. Same size as Peasy's Knapp. Now, you wouldn't think it to hear Monroe talk. He can blow and bombast till he fair scunners you. Now, he's little enough reason. The place is needed, been mucked for a harvest this spring. That maybe accounts for Monroe's neck.
His neck?
Some folks say he can't get the mud washed out of it. Others say he's never tried.
You're not friends, then?
Oh, aye, friends enough. There's worse folk than Monroe. The chases maybe they're all in jail. Ah, but no harm to the pair of them. She's always ready to go out at any time of the night when some poor billy comes dropping at her window.
And why is that?
Oh, she's the best midwife for miles around.
It's fine to have one handy.
Why, she's out before you can whistle and snapping her orders round the kitchen and telling the poor soul in childbed she might easily be worse.
Druids work, they say. That's what they say. They were set up by the Druids. He'll be the new tenant at Blaweary.
Aye. Guthrie. John Guthrie. Yourself?
Rob Duncan. Long Rob, they call me. I work the mill.
So likely we'll be seeing each other.
Likely? It's rough, coarse ground about here.
Oh, it's that. I'm a bit like it myself. And I've been sweating and shoving away for 3 years to turn it into a park. But, oh, it's no half done yet.
Well, trade must be slack at the mill if you've time to waste on it.
Oh, make time, man. I'm working when the rest of Kinraddy's away to bed. And I'm out again at the Keek of Day before the half of them's up. Keeps me at it from Monday to Sunday.
That's away some dark splatter of water.
They say there's no bottom to it. Like the depth of a parson's depravity.
Now, that's an ill thing to say about any minister.
It's an ill thing to say about any loch.
You'll get hard on the kirk, Mr. Duncan.
Well, I've as much time for it as it has for me. And that's no much. I'm an atheist. Though, if Christ came down to Kinraddy, he'd be welcome enough to a bit meal or milk at the mill. But damn the thing he'd get at the manse.
These were the first of the Kinraddy folk we met. But as that winter wore on and spring came in, we soon got to know the others right well, as well as they knew one another.
Oh, aye, Alec Much is a grand worker. And Bridge End's no the worst farm in Kinraddy. But he's well kenned he's up to his great big muckle ears in debt. No wonder well he's a slummock like her for a wife. Cigarettes never out of her mouth. She's the speaker of half the merns we are smoking. There's never a mortal thing worries her. She aye just lights up a cigarette like a tink and says,
ah, well, it'll make no difference 100 years after I'm dead.
I pay no attention to what they say, though some of them have fine notions of themselves. Like God of Upper Hill. You steer with Alec, that's my husband, says about him.
He struts about with his stick as proud as a cock in a midden. Oh, Gordonfleer fancies himself with his big farm and his leggings and his breeches. Mrs. Gordon's the same. Her father was some bit post office creature up in Stonehaven. Oh, God, to hear her talk, you would think he'd invented the post office and taken out a patent for it. And she's a fierce scunner when she starts talking about her two lassies.
Of course, Nellie and Maggie Jean go to Stonehaven Academy. I'm very anxious to learn not to speak coarse. Oh, they're so intelligent, I'm sure they'll be a great credit to me. Mind you, Maggie Jean's awful delicate. Yes, I had to take her to a specialist in Aberdeen just recently.
Now, when I took my pig to see the specialist in Edinburgh, he up and said, Mr. Rob, this is a most unusual pig, but so intelligent. And you should send him to the academy, and someday he'll be a real credit to you.
You know, there's no secrets in Kinraddy, Chris.
What did Mrs. Gordon say?
Well, she turned as red as fire, and she forgot her English, and she cried out, Rob Duncan's a Nora Tink brute.
Chris, get on with your studies. You've no time for daffing, and you will. Leave her alone.
Oh, I think the lassie does too much studying as it is. I never see you out with your friends, Chris.
The only quines of my own age are the servants up at the Mains.
You'll stay away from them, do you hear? They're nothing but gugs and gomerals screeching around the barn at night with the ploughman snickering after them.
The lassie needs friends.
Friends? Stick to your lessons and make a name for yourself. You've no time for friends.
Take care our head doesn't soften with lessons. Books and learning can send folk clean skite.
Would you rather see a skite with learning or skite with...
With what, John?
With the sort of things that can happen in a godless parish like this.
Kinraddy may or may not have lacked a god, but it certainly lacked a minister. And three of them came down to try for its empty pulpit.
What's today's candidate like?
Cahoon's his name. He's an Arlsbit man for Banff.
Well, he might be best. He'll quieten down at his age. No Ivy on the lookout for a bigger kirk and a bigger stipend.
Aye, you're right there, Alec. For if there's a body on earth that can skin a tink for his skin or preach a sermon in purgatory, it's an old kirk minister.
I'm told he's spent years writing books and things.
And likely all his spunks trickled out of his pen.
No, no, there's no harm in books.
Maybe no, but I hope he doesn't read his sermon. The Raddy's no liking for a minister that reads his sermon.
But he did read his sermon. And that verse settled his hash to begin with. So hardly a soul paid heed to his reading, except myself and John Guthrie. But I thought it fine. He told of the long dead beasts of the Scottish land, in the times when jungle flowered its forests across the Howe, and a red sun rose on the steaming earth that the feet of man had still to tread. And he pictured the dark, slow tribes that came drifting across the lowlands of the northern seas. The great bear watched them come, and they hunted and fished and loved and died. God's children in the morn of time. And he brought the first voyagers sailing the sounding coasts, and they built the heathen idols of the great stone rings. The golden age was over and past, and lust and cruelty trod the world.
But this too passed, and Christ was arisen. A pinpoint of cosmic light far off in Palestine. The light that crept and wavered and did not die. The light that will yet shine as the sun on all the world, not least on the dark howes and hills of Scotland. Let us pray.
He seems to think Kinraddy's the right course place since all the jungle's dried up.
Aye, and his prayers were guy short.
Have you a word to say for the king or royal family at all?
Lads, we'll kend you're a great king's man, Alec. Ready to die for him every day of the week and twice on Sundays. Still, I didn't think much of the Reverend Cahoon myself.
Because he didn't praise up your socialism, eh?
That's what sermons should be about, how the rich and poor should be equal. What do you say, Bulweary?
I liked him fine. He'll get my vote.
He'll get faint few others.
Father doesn't like anybody touching his shotgun. Nobody must handle it but himself. You've heard him say it.
Ach, it's only an old muzzle loader.
Please, Will, he'll be fell angry if he finds out.
Well, he'll not find out. Hey, did you hear what Rob Duncan said about this?
Will, please.
He cried out, "Aye, man, I didn't know you were a veteran of the 45. And Guthrie comes back with, "Losh, Rob, were you cheating folk at your mill even then? Oh, aye, Father can take a bit joke now and then. From everyone except his family.
I thought I had more than that. Jane? You've been touching my shot bag.
And why would I want to do that?
Well, somebody has. There's barely enough here for one charge. So where are they?
Hold your fish, John, you and your gun.
Now, Gina, I'm asking you a question.
What harm was in Will that he used it?
You were using the gun, eh?
Aye.
Come out to the barn with me, Will.
Father, you can't.
Quiet, Chris.
Will's near 17. He's over old to be
quiet, murdered. Quiet, else I'll take you as well.
Father's roused, lass. You might as well cry to the tides at Kinneff to keep away from the land.
You saw, didn't he?
Oh, I can hardly sleep for the pain it Chris. Oh, I hate him, Chris. I hate him.
After a while, he stopped crying and fell asleep. And strange it seemed to me then, for I knew him bigger and older than I was. And somehow, skin and hair and body, stranger than once they had been, as though we were no longer children.
Let us pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed.
The Reverend Stuart Gibbon was the third minister to make a try for the Kinraddy manse. And as I looked up at him, I knew well he'd please the Kinraddy folk. His sermon, it was out of the Song of Solomon, and well and rare he preached it.
How beautiful are thy feet with shoes, O prince's daughter. The joints of thy thighs are like jewels, the work of the hands of cunning craftsmen. Thy navel is like a round goblet which wanteth not liquor. Thy belly is like an heap of wheat set about with lilies. Thy two breasts are like two young roes that are twins. The Song of Solomon has more meaning than one. It is Christ's description of the beauty and fine comeliness of the kirk. And it is also a picture of womanly beauty, which molds itself in the lithe and grace of that kirk. As such, it is a perpetual manual for the women of Scotland, so that they may attain straight and fine lives in this world, and salvation in the next.
I'm no saying but what he said the prayers right well.
Aye, and there was one or two of them joined in right near the end, and that's gay seldom done in the Auld Kirk.
Mind you, he begged to be forgiven for his sins and not his trespasses.
And what's the difference?
Well, trespasses sound more genteel.
Oh, he's a pretty man and no mistake. Right, girly bull.
There was fair tickle to hear things like that read from the pulpit about a woman's breasts and thighs. Gee. And to know it was decent scripture with a higher meaning as well.
Aye, I heard about him, the Reverend Gibbon. Well, preaching like that's a fine way of having your bit pleasure by proxy right in the front stalls of the kirk. I prefer to take mine more private-like.
Well, there's few that'd put off tramping in to vote for him.
No doubt. I heard they all sat there listening to him as though he was promising to pay their taxes at Martimus. Likely you'll be seeing him soon.
Oh, you think so?
Since the beginning of time in Kinrady, every minister has made a round of the parish when he was inducted. Some of them did it quick, and some did it slow. I think the Reverend Gibbon's one of the quick.
Oh, it's coarse land hereabouts, Mr. Gibbon. Wet and raw most of the time. Parched and sucked dry, like now, when there's a drought.
As you say. It's only a man from the north who could handle it so well. Man like yourself, Mr. Gibbon.
Come here, Quine, and meet Mr. Gibbon. This is my daughter, Chris. Mm-hmm. Well, girl, have you lost your tongue?
How do you do, sir?
Yeah, fine-looking lass, Mr. Guthrie. I hear you're right clever, Chrissy.
She does well enough. She's at the college.
And how do you like it, eh?
Fine, sir.
Ah, good, good. It takes education to smooth the path through life, as I'm sure your father's told you.
Aye, sir.
Uh-huh. And what is it you want to be?
Like fine to be a teacher.
Ah, you couldn't have a better ambition. There's no profession more honourable.
I'm sorry I had to dash away, Mr. Gibbon, but if I don't put the twins to bed when they want to...
Oh, don't apologize, Mrs. Guthrie. I've been quite content sitting here listening to your husband's conversation and enjoying your excellent tea.
Let me get you another cup.
Thank you. No, I must be dandering along now. Well, it's been a pleasure meeting you, Mr. Guthrie. And Mrs. Guthrie.
I'll just see you down the road, Mr. Gibbon.
Thank you. Come over and see us some evening, Chrissy. Maybe the wife and I will be able to lend you some books to help in your studies, eh? Hmm? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I thought since I was passing, I'd just stop by and see how you were, Jean.
Oh, I'm fine, Kirsty. It's been a while yet.
Hello, hi, Chris.
Hello, Mrs. Drake.
What are you doing in a day like this? Please, there hasn't been a drought like this since 83. As the Lord Rob says, you can't blame this one in Gladstone. Religio Medici. That's a queer-looking name for a book.
I got a loan of it from the minister.
Oh, you've been up at the manse then, have you? Did you meet Mistress Gibbon?
No, she was busy with her spring cleaning or something.
Mm-hmm. I hear she's a bonny enough young thing in a thin kind of way. I'm told she's some English creature he married in Edinburgh.
You can tell they're right fond of each other.
Oh, aye. I hear they kiss every time he goes out for a bit of a walk.
You can hear a lot of things about other folk in Kinrady.
Oh, but it's true, though. Once he came back from a bit of a jaunt and found her waiting for him, so he picked her up in his arms and ran upstairs, the both of them cuddling one another.
Chris, away up and strip the beds, your own and Will's. You can give me a hand to wash the blankets.
Aye, Mother. It's true, though. I heard it from the servant, Quine, heard that comes from Gordon.
Heard what?
But the minister and his wife, into their bedroom they went and closed the door. And they didn't come down for hours. They're just there in the middle of the afternoon.
It comes to the same thing at any time.
Lad for a squine.
Aye, John. Have you ever seen a drought the likes of this before?
You shameless slimmer. Get your clothes on. Sense at all, woman.
Sense enough. The day's gay foot.
What would folks say of the quine if they saw her there, near naked? We'd be the speaking laughing stock of the place.
Well, it wouldn't be the first time you've seen a naked lass yourself. And if your neighbors haven't, they must have fathered their own bairns with her bricks on.
It had been as though I saw a caged beast peep from his eyes. Like a fire that burned across the close, it went on and on as though I still stood there and he glowered at me. I hid my face below the blankets, but I couldn't forget. Next morning, when I was able to bear thinking of it no longer, I went to Mother and asked her straight. I'd never asked her anything of the kind before.
Oh, Chris, don't ask me. Men? Men and bairns? I can't tell you a thing or advise you a thing.
Mother, what's wrong?
Is it... I heard you talking to Kirsty Strachan.
Oh, Mother, I didn't mean to vex.
It's not you, Chris Quine. It's just life. You'll have to face men for yourself when the time comes. There's none can stand and help you. Chris? Mind that for me sometime. If I can't thole it any longer.
Thole what, Mother? What's the matter?
Oh, we're daft, a pair of us. Away and fetch me a pail of water.
I went out into the red hot weather. And then something came on me. I crept back soft footed. And there Mother stood as I'd left her. White, lonely and sad. I didn't dare go into her. I just stood and looked. Something was happening to Mother. Things were happening to all of us. Nothing stayed the same, except maybe this weather. And if it went on much longer, the old minister's jungles would soon be sprouting back across the parks of the How. somebody was crying on me.
Mind that for me sometime, if I can't thole it any longer. Poor Jean. It all came out at the inquiry. She poisoned herself. Herself and the twins.
So I heard. Well, of an unsound mind, they said. Imagine that. An unsound mind.
Aye, maybe so. She was pregnant again, you see, and near daft with the fear of it.
You tell me the lassie Chris never cried for days, but when she started, they couldn't get her stopped.
Poor Jean.
Aye. An unsound mind.
Never be the same again. But the world went on, and you went with it. It was not only mother and the twins that had died. The child in your heart had died too. The bairn that believed the hills were made for its play. Every road set fair with its warning posts and hands ready to snatch you back from the brink of danger. That died. And the Chris of the books and dreams died with it.
Well, you believe in college now, I'll warrant. Education's dirt, and you'd better clear of it.
You'll find little time for dreaming when you're keeping house at Blaweary.
You thought of the hours and days as a dark, cold pit you'd never escape. But you'd escaped. The black damp went out of the sunshine. And the world went on. The white faces and whispering ceased from the pit. You'd never be the same again. But the world went on, and you went with it. So you folded up your dreams and laid them away by the dark, quiet corpse that was your childhood.
You'll get back to school if I say so. And if I have any more of your lip, I'll leather your backside until the skin turns blue.
The boys have enough to put up with. They're afraid to go back to school. I afraid and ashamed.
Nobody in my house has anything to feel ashamed for.
No, is that a fact? Not even your mother called a dafty.
Now you watch your tongue.
Well, that's what folk are saying, isn't it? Why should Alec and Dodd go back to school? I wouldn't.
Now I'm warning you one more word.
Ah, you needn't glower at me. You take damn good care you never go near a mart or a market yourself nowadays. I have to do all your dirty work for you.
By God, I'll smash your face in.
Take care, Guthrie. Take care.
Will, I need this table for baking.
And the thing I've been meaning to ask you, where do you wander to at night, like a tank?
What's to be done, then?
About Dodd and Alec?
I was wondering if Uncle Tom and Auntie Janet would take them.
Those two. Uncle Tom and his wee tin medals.
Whatever you think, Will, they're kind enough folk and the boys would get their schooling in Aberdeen. Do you think he'll ask them?
Well, if he does, he'll be too proud to tell us.
So you're taking them, then?
Aye, aye, no doubt about it, aye.
Dodd and Alec will be fair pleased at the thought of coming to stay with you.
Aye, I will get on fine. I'll teach the boys to play kites, aye. That's a grand game. Yeah, I'm on the east for playing kites.
Aye, well, that's it settled then.
And that just settled, Joan. If we take the boys, we want to keep them.
Aye, what's that?
Janet means that we would like to adopt them.
So you'd steal the flesh of my body from me?
Aye, Joan, just that. We've never a wane of our own. Though God knows it's no for the one to try.
Ill blood breeds ill.
Aye, it'll be a long time before I have to kill myself, because my man beds me like a breeding sow.
You dirty bitch.
I know, careful, Guthrie. She might be your sister, but she's my wife.
Aye, and you're well matched to pair you.
At least you didn't saddle me with a kist full of bairns.
No, he was never man enough.
No, Guthrie, and you were man enough to see your wife in the kirkyard before her time.
You hear what she's saying to me?
Aye, you should be lipped for what you did.
Stand any longer.
Ach, never heed the dirty old devils. One's as bad as the other. Father, auntie, that midden that's covered with its wee tin medals. Come away to the park with me and we'll bring home the kye. Don't let Father make a damned slave of you, Chris, as he'd like to do.
That's easy enough said, Will.
You were meant for better things in the weary plighter of the land and its life. She sit and wait for the rain or the thaw.
Aye. Can't be that often enough. Though Father wouldn't agree. You know what he aye says. The salt of the earth are the folk that drive a straight drill and never look back.
Ach, to hell with what Guthrie says. You do what you want.
I might. If I knew what it was. I'm like a ploughed field, Will, with all the furrows going crisscross. What else can I do but bide at home now?
I don't know, but I'll be libbed, poleaxed, and gutted if I stay here. We've our own lives to lead.
Where'll you go?
Canada, maybe. Man can soon be his own master there.
Canada? Oh, Will, and you could send for me as your housekeeper.
Well, maybe. But maybe it would hardly suit you.
Is
that the only reason, what? Or is there some other lass you'd sooner take?
There's a lass in Drumlithy. Molly Douglas, she's called.
And she's the one you go to see every night. I wondered what Father meant.
Come on. We'd best get the Kai home.
With Alec and Dodd gone, there were only three of us sitting to meet at the kitchen table. I listened for days for voices of folk that were dead or gone. But even that lost its strangeness in time. The harvest drew on. Lush and heavy enough, it had sprung and yellowed with the suns and rains of the last 2 months.
Did you look at it? We should have left that old thing at Echt.
Wished Willie might hear you.
No, I don't care if he does. But he wants to get us a binder. Save our backs.
Have you nothing to do, the pair of you? There's a harvest to be gathered in.
You'd gather it a sight quicker if you bought a binder.
I'll no hear of the things. The old reaper's fine enough for them that's willing to work. Not that there's many about. But when folk breed, they all breed again. The scythe will come back into its own. Aye, and your reapers and binders will rot and rust.
Ah, well, this one has, for how long? I'm damned if I'll be seen driving the thing. I'll be the fool of Kinraddy.
If Kinraddy's laughing can make a bigger fool of you than nature did, it'll be a miracle. Don't fret your doubt, my manny. I'll do the driving. Chris, you follow down at the tail and gather the shaves in. Come on then, boy. Yep.
Every year at harvest time, there came something terrible and queer on Father. Couldn't handle a thing with him. It was as if he grew stronger and crueler then, ripe and strong to the strength of the corn.
Get on with it now! I want that boat clear by the time I come back!
Be the best weather for the harvest, but it's all to cut in a swither of heat, eh?
It won't last well. The rain's due.
God help the crops that wait cutting then.
Is the maestro about?
What is it?
I'm looking for work, if you've got any.
Maybe. Maybe. Let's see the work. You've earned your first.
Aye. Fine, that.
Thank you. can sleep in here. There's a bed made up.
Aye. In the morrow?
Well, I'll maybe take you on for a day or so if the weather holds.
I'll be real content with that.
Mm-hmm. I'll send my daughter out for some supper for you.
See, the tinker's not eating with us, then.
No, wouldn't have him in the house. The creature might be rotten with lice. There's no good doing kindness to tinks.
I'm sorry you have to take your supper out here. I'd have had you eat in the house if it wasn't for Father.
Don't you fuss yourself about that, lass. I'm as little anxious for his company as he is for mine. For by, he's just a Kinradi clown.
I've not lain with man yet, lass. I can see. Oh, that's a sore waste of hot blood like yours. So mind, if you want me, I'll be here. Mind not. I'll be here if you want me.
With the stookin, and the weather might break.
All right, might.
We'll be working night soon.
Not me. I'm having nothing to do with night working. Good night, Chris.
Chris, get to your bed when you've finished the milking.
Aye, Father.
So that was the harvest madness that came upon us. That set Father singing hymns in the fields with a queer, keen shrillness that brought the sweat to the palms of your hands. That sent Will off to his lass in Drumlithy, evening upon evening. That caused, without beginning or reason, a strange ache to come in me. In my breasts, in my throat, and below my heart. And I thought of the tink lying there, and how easy it would be to steal down the stairs, across the close, dense black in the shadows, to the barn. But then I would laugh at the daft thoughts, and look at myself in the glass. I was growing up. Not bonny, perhaps, but limber and sweet. And so I saw myself, with that grave brown face John Guthrie's blood had bequeathed me. So strange it felt, with the beams of moonlight running across me. And I thought myself sweet and cool and fit for that lover who would someday come and hold me. So. Aye, the harvest madness was out in Kinradi, and if I was quick to master mine, others were not so fleet.
Tavendale.
That's my name. You and Tavendale.
Oh, I ken who you are. You ken who I am, so you'll ken what I'm here about.
You're Shea Strachan from Peasy's Knap. Sarah Sinclair's brother-in-law.
Just that. Alec Mutch says he saw you and Sarah coming out of the larch wood up by.
Does he know?
Don't deny it. You near jumped out of your skins, the pair of you, when he cried goodnight. The story'll be all over Kinradi by now.
Aye, likely it would be.
You might try and hide with your lass at the top of Ben Nevis. 10 to 1 when you got there, you'd find some old Kinradi creek sniggering themselves daft at your shame.
Well, what do you intend to do about it, eh? Have you a mind to marry her, then?
I think she's a bit old for me.
What the hell are you laughing at?
Little. damn little. Myself, I feel like weeping at the sight of it.
Oh, Marche was more than a match for young Tavendale. Coarse, dour, Highland brute. But then the rest of the bothy lads up and went for him.
I heard that Che got home to Peasy's nap with hardly a stitch in his back.
Aye, maybe so. But he left young Tavendale with a black eye big enough to sold your husband's boots.
Oh, it's fair terrible what goes on in Kinraddy. Munro went up to see the minister at the manse the other day. He wanted Gibbon's signature and some lawyer's paper. But the minister wasn't at home. At least that's what he was told. But as he was coming home through the man's garden, he heard some rustling and squealing in the grass. So Munro picked up some gravel and threw it. And you'll never guess what.
What?
Up out of the grass rises the maid from the manse, and she goes trailing past Munro with a glazed look in her face.
Wanton bitch.
Aye. But there's more. Next thing, Munro finds the Reverend Gibbon at his elbow, breathing great deep bass, and Munro says, well, well, Mr. Gibbon, you've surely been running a race. And straight into the manse he goes without a word, just slamming the door with a bang. It made Cuddyston loping his boots. Well, that should about do it, I think.
I thought you never spread scandal about folk, Rob.
I don't, only about horses. It may be a class minister's lower than them.
Oh, well, likely the story's true enough.
That can be imagination. Munro never had any. Aye. First you and Tavendale and then the minister. Must be the time of the year. How was your harvest at Blue Eyrie?
Oh, the crops have fared none too badly this once. But you can see in a normal year, the corn will hardly come at all.
Ah, it's fell coarse land you've got in these long, stiff slopes.
I've been staggered by the dourness of it. You know, it's coming plain to me, Rob, that the day of the crofter is finished. The day of the folk like ourselves. The last of the farming folk that wring their living from the land with their own bare hands. It's a sign of the times, Rob. Aye. A sign of the times when ministers go out and whore with the rest. A sign of the times when women take their own lives or flaunt their harlotries as they please.
A sign of the times he saw in mother's killing of herself to shame him. For bitterness had grown and eaten away into the heart of him in his year at Blue Eyrie. And he saw a darkness down on the land he loved better than his soul or God.
Aye, laugh, you mucker.
Then one night, I heard him get out of bed and go slow padding about like a great cat. Beast that sniffed and planned and smelled at the night. And he came soft along the cowering creek of the landing to stop by my door. I held my breath, near sick with fright. Though what was there to be feared of? I heard his breath come quick and gasping, and the scuffle of his hand on the snick of the door. Then that stopped, and the house was quiet. But I didn't dare sleep again, till Will came cluttering home in the still small hours.
Chris, go see to the cattle before you go to bed.
I'll see to them, Father.
See the burning winds up Drumtochty way, Chris? Come away up the hill and have a try at ours. They're damn sore and need it.
I've got my jelly to make you gawk.
Ach, to hell with your jelly. We'll all soon be jelly and bones in our grave ourselves. Come on.
best leave it till Father's there.
Ah, maybe you're right. If the fire caught the fence, old Guthrie would be casting me out to Blaweary for bringing his grey hairs in sorrow to the grave.
What would you do if he did put you out?
I would go.
Would you get a fee?
Oh, aye, damn the fears of that.
You're the harvest nearly over. You don't look all that sure to me. Well.
All right.
I met Douglas in Drumlithy yesterday. She asked me to ask you to go and see her. Well.
Oh, I heard you. What's the good? I can't have a coin like other folk. I haven't even got a fee, as you said.
Maybe she doesn't want your fee. Just you.
Please, Chris, tell Walt to ride over and see me again. Tell him to come tonight. I just can't bear it without him any longer. I don't care if that sounds shameless. Chris, I can see what you're thinking. Think that then, like all the rest of them, but it isn't true. I just love him so sore. I can't live if I don't see Will.
They're saying things about her and you and Drumlithy.
Who are saying things?
Galt and other coor stinks like that.
Galt, the gardener, yon big creesh.
Aye. I was in getting the blackberries for the jam the other day, and he looked at me in a queer kind of way. Then he started joking and hinting. And saying things.
What things?
Oh, aye. When is in much a wall here of late? Faith and the roses are fair fading from Molly Douglas's cheeks.
What do I say? That Molly's with a bairn to you, and that you're biding away from her now.
God said that.
He hinted at it. But he'll do more than hint when he's not speaking to a sister of yours.
He said that about Molly. The orra swine. God, I'll mash that bloody Galt's head in so his own mother won't know
it. Well, I know how you feel. I could have clouted him myself. But that would only stir up worse scandal. Folk would just snigger and say there was something sure in the story of Molly's condition.
Well, what am I to do, Chris?
Do you love her, Will?
I'm away to Drumlithy.
Very well, it's a fine night.
Don't get it tonight, Will. The grass is all wet for lying on.
Speaking to me.
Who else?
Young Guffy, you fear gone daft. The man's old enough to be your father.
Yeah. If I had a father like that, I'd kill him, then go drown myself.
Your father's in the kitchen, is he?
Aye, sir.
Aye. Right.
Good evening, Mr. Guthrie. Can I have a word with Will?
Well, Father wants you. He's got the minister with him.
What does he want?
You can find. He'll have heard about that tushy you had with Galt last night.
Do you think so?
Oh, Will, everybody's heard of it. You're the laughing stock of Kinraddy.
Oh, but Chris, when I went to Drumlithy, I had no intention of doing anything but seeing Molly.
Oh, I believe you. Will, if he wants to talk to you about... Well, anything else?
Aye, I'll keep my temper. Molly made me swear not to fly into a rage if they started their course hinting at her.
What's this I hear about you and some aura tink bitch in Drumlithy?
What the devil are you talking about?
Answer my question, Will.
Well, put a question with some sense in it, then.
Show some respect for your father, Will.
Look, I'm not a mind reader.
Damn to hell, you cross brute. I might have been up with your lip as well as your whoring every night.
Mr. Guthrie,
is it true there's a tink called Molly Douglas that's with bairn by you?
If you call Molly Douglas a tink again, I'll knock your damn teeth down your throat.
Oh, well.
Ah, even if you are my father. Mind.
Chris, get your bed.
Ah, don't bother, Chris.
Just a moment, Will.
Where are you going?
Now, I care all's that keen, I should lie with my lass and get her with Bairn. I'm off to try and oblige you.
Minister for a bit. Will, I heard what you said when you went away. But you didn't do it.
Wouldn't be for want of being pushed into it by half the holy muckers in Kinradi if I had. I bet you need have no fears on that. I'd as soon cut my own throat as too hurt to Molly.
So the minister's interfering brought no harm. And faith, he'd more need to scrub out his own bit byer. If the story of the servant quine was true. And soon after that, a worse scandal went on the rounds about him. And the way of it was that a bit daughter was born to the manse. And, proud as punch, he preached a grand sermon that Sunday.
For unto us a child is born.
Child is born. They've been celebrating in Aberdeen.
Fell asleep on the train and went past Kinradi. Kinradi. Oh, what a bloody place Kinradi is.
How would you like to live between a briar bush and a rotten kale yard in the lee of a house with green shutters, eh? Bloody green shutters. Bloody Kinradi. Can't you lie down with a quine for a minute with some half-witted clod-hopping crofter? He begins to throw stones at you. He threw a bloody stone at me. A little respect for God, a Kirker minister down in Kinradi.
Man, it's awful the way the world's going. You ken, I thought of resigning from the railway myself and taking to preaching. But after what you told me, I won't.
So the winter came on and brought the first threshing of the season down in Kinradi. Father and Will were off to Peasy's Knap at the peak of dawn. And an hour later, I followed to help Kirsty with the dinner and things.
Looks as if we'll need some more broth, Chris. Monroe will be in a minute and he eats as if he hasn't seen food for a fortnight.
I took a look through there and there's broth and chicken and beef and oat cakes and
loaves and jelly and dumplings. So if anybody's gutsy enough to want more, he can away down to the turnip field and help himself.
Man, goodness, and you're eating like a collie dog just let off its chain.
Oh, you can fair build up an appetite at the threshing.
Aye, to some folk helping a neighbour with the threshing's just a friendly act. The others, it's nae more than a spree.
Ah, Chris. Maybe just another 1 day or two, Chris. Man, Blaweerish is fair expert getting your daughter. Aye, the kitchen's more her style than college.
Aye, you're right there.
Aye. No, I wouldn't say that, good Easton.
Aye, it's true enough. Education does more harm than good.
No, that's not exactly what I said.
But it's a fact. It's a coarse thing, learning. A coarse thing. Teaches your children a lot of damned nonsense that puts them above themselves. Aye, some of them would turn round and give you a lip as quick as look at you.
Well, I suppose.
For a moment. I saw the ill nature grin from the faces of them. And suddenly, I hated the lot. The other Chris of the books came back into my skin. And I saw them. The yokels and clowns everlasting. Dull-brained and crude. Then I was shamed, as I thought. Che and Long Rob they were, my clowns and yokels. The poorest folk in Kinraddy.
That man, you're clean wrong, sir, about education. Education's the thing the working man needs to bring him up level with the rest.
I would have thought of his balance in the bank, would you?
Now, look here, what I'm saying is...
I agree with what you're saying, man. I agree with you.
All right.
The more education, the more sense, and the less a cacks in ministry.
Now, we'll have no curse words about religion here.
Aye, Chris,
take.
Aye, Will. There's plenty of room over there.
Aye,
Chris, get a chair for
them. Why don't you do it out there, look well.
Aye. Aye. How are you getting on, Chris?
Oh, fine. How are you?
Well, my back would feel a damn sight easier if I'd spent the day in bed. Hey, Tavendale. Chris, this is Ewan Tavendale.
How do you do?
Chris, Ewan's the foreman at Upper Hill.
Ken, I've heard about... Sit down and I'll get you some food. So that was who. He looked over young for the coarse-doer brute folk said he was. He had a face like a wild cat. Strong and quick. I half liked it. And half hated it. Aye, but then if you could read every child's nature in the way he wiped his nose, it'd be a fine and easy world to go through. That's what Long Rob said.
Father! Chris! Wake up! Wake up!
What's wrong? What's up?
See that light down there in the nap?
What is it, Will? What's the matter?
Hey, take a look out the window. Peasy's nap's on fire. God, it'll be all ablaze in a minute. Hope they've wakened.
Damn to fear. The Strachan's go straight to bed at the chop of 8. Che'll sleep himself out of this world and into hell in his own firewood if he isn't roused.
God, we'll need ropes and pails.
Then don't stand there like a gout. Get them! Oh, hey. Chris, you bite it home now, mind!
Come on, Chris, what's keeping you?
Oh, I can't find my corsets.
Ah, damn your corsets.
Oh, light a match, Will, and come in.
Light up, can't you? Lights are springing up all over Kinraddy. Half the men's will have seen the blaze. We're up with the last ones there, Chris.
Oh, there they are. They slipped down behind the kist.
Oh, you're fine without them. You should never have been born a quine.
I wish I had. Sampler. There's somebody trapped in the barn.
No, it's a horse.
Oh, God, that's old Clytie.
Two stacks and two cows, that's what I've left.
It was all we could save, Che. I'm right sorry, Che.
I wouldn't even have that if you and John Guthrie hadn't gone in for them. Ah, I was glad when the roof fell in and killed the other beasts.
Aye. God, man, I never went to smell roasting beef again.
Che?
Hi, Chris.
You seen my father or Will anywhere?
Likely they'll have gone home, lass. There's little to do here now but glower at the fire and its mischief.
Aye. Well, I'll away to my bed then. Night, Che. Night, Kirsty.
Aye. Good night.
Oh, sorry.
It was the first time a man had ever kissed me like that. Dark and frightening and terrible on the winter road. And that night, it was in my memory. Like being chased and bitten by a beast, but worse. And with something else in it. As though half I'd liked the beast and the biting, and that soft, unshaven cheek against my own. And then I fell asleep and dreamed of him. An awful dream that made me blush even while I knew I was dreaming. That Hogmanay in 1912, we read up the beasts early in the evening. And then, after supper, sat close round the fire.
God, I wonder why Jean left us.
And so we sat, thinking of her that was by us so kind and friendly and quick that last new year. So cold and quiet and forgotten now, with the little dead twins in the kirkyard of Kinradi.
Happy
New Year!
Am I there first?
Are you fairly lucky?
What a night it is.
You must be freezing.
Oh, I am that
lass.
Oh, dear.
Happy New Year, Rob.
Happy New Year, Steve.
You'll take a dram, Rob.
Oh, will that? My Mauser's near frozen with that walk up the hill.
Well, that'll thaw it out.
More company, John?
Oh, it sounds like it. Good New Year to
your health.
Happy New Year! I'm at that foot in a minute. Oh, rest.
Good, see. Good, good,
cheer.
You've been a sweet
day all night. Come on, cheer. You started early by the look of things.
Oh, there's some women would drive any man to drink.
Kirsty?
No. Her mother. God, she gets worse with the years. Near gins her face off with the bairns as much as make a bit howl. It's plain unreasonable that bairns I fight like tinks. Happy New Year, dear.
Good New Year to you, cheer.
Ah, that's true, Jake. As it says in the hymn, it's a dog's delight to bark and fight.
Is it?
Aye, and faith, the average human can outdog any cur that was ever pupped. Now, horses are different.
Ah, oh, away to hell.
No, I've got my Schulte and my Clydesdale, and we're fine friends, the three of us.
Man, I've seen you leather the beast until folks spoke us ending for the cruelty.
A sound bit leathering and a pinch of kindness. That's the way to treat a horse.
Damn time, maybe you're right. It's a pity somebody wouldn't treat Kirsty's mother like that. She would deave a door nail with her fines and plaints. Thrown old Tory bitch.
No, there's worse folk in the Tories.
Ah, well, must keep themselves damn well hidden. If I had my way, I would have all the Tories put into barrels of spikes and rolled down the Grampians.
Well, then there'd be a guy booming the barrel trade. The most the Kinradi would be inside them.
And damn good riddance to rubbish.
The storm had cleared by the time they left, and I watched the two of them leave in the bright starlight. Not very steady, either of them, to go down into shrouded Kinradi, lying below. For a while, up into the new year, April and the turnip time, things at Blaweary went fair and smooth. One night, when Will had gone off to Drumlithy, and Father was up on the moor with his gun, I set myself a great baking. Warm work it was in that fine weather. So, alone in the house, I nearly stripped.
Hello. Is Will about?
No. He's gone to Drumlithy, I think.
As we stood there blushing, I thought, such a look he's taking. It's a pity he can't study the blush to its end.
Well, I was hoping I'd see him, in case he should leave suddenly.
Leave? Who said Will was leaving?
Oh, I heard he was trying for a job in Aberdeen. Maybe it's a lie. Tell him I called in.
Aye.
Ta-ta.
Ta-ta, Ewan. Oh! But I guessed right well something new it was that kept Will so quiet, saying no more than his say at plate or park. Yet if you looked at him, you'd more likely than not see him smiling to himself.
Well, breakfast ready.
All right. Come in.
I'm going to have the hay down with the scythe this year. Not spoil the stuff with the moor.
All right. All right.
Is that all you have to say?
Well, what did you expect me to say?
Thank you, Chris.
Ah, hold your damn weeper. Save your breath for the forking.
No, not today. I'm off to Aberdeen. Well, the old fool thinks he can frighten me still.
Avondale was down to see you last night. He thought you'd be leaving Blaweary.
Did he? God, it fair talk the breeks off a healing when the gossipers are Kinraddy. If I know Tavendale, he came down to take a bit kick at you, Chris, lass.
Oh, Havers will.
Now, well, he's Highland and coarse, so take care of yourself. Chris. Lord, I wish you were coming with me.
What, to Aberdeen? I'd like to, fine, but I can't. Hurry up and dress, or you'll miss your train.
Hi. No, Chris, I'll be down in a minute. Well, will I do?
My, you look fair brave.
Ach, Havers. Well, ta-ta, Chris.
Well, what's the matter?
What the hell?
I watched him go down the Blaweary Road as fast as he could walk. But he hardly looked in Father's direction, nor Father at him. Sina heard him whistling bonny and clear as he did in the days when we went up the school road together. After a while, he looked round and stood still and waved his hand because he knew I was watching. Then a queer kind of pain came into my throat. My eyes smarted and I told myself I was daft. Wallo was only off for the day. He'd be back at night. But Will didn't come back that night. He didn't come back next day. He came back never again to John Guthrie's Kinraddy.
Aye, he altered his birth certificate and married her.
Aye, I know. They say that Guthrie went up to Aberdeen and raged at the police.
Aye, the police just laughed at him and asked him if he'd lain with the quine himself that he was so mad at his son.
Oh, aye. It's fair to speak of the parish. It's all this education and dirt breeds nothing but a lot of damned impudence.
Ah, it was fair shameful of Will to go off and leave his father like that. He should think black burning shame.
It just shows you what the world's coming to. You're here up bairns expecting to get a bit of comfort in your old age, and what did you get?
I know.
Still, it'll maybe bring John Guthrie's pride down a wee bit to have folk laughing at him.
It's from Will. They've gone to the Argentine.
Aye, the Argentine. You wrote to Chris from Southampton. Seems that Molly Douglas's mother has some kin out there, and they got him a job as a cattleman in some big bald Angus ranch.
What's it like out there, Che? You're a well-travelled child.
to the fine place, would you think?
That's fine, fine. Mind I've never actually been there, but it's a guy fine place, no doubt.
You can depend on it. That coarse young Guthrie brute will never thrive.
Dartman, young Guthrie's no fool to spread his but wings. Or just the same myself.
There'll be a judgment on him, you'll see. Him and his coarse tink quine.
It's Chris, Father. You've hurt yourself.
Leave me be. Get into the house, you white-faced bitch.
Mighty me, Mr. Guthrie. This is a sore, sore sight. Whatever will you do now?
Well, whatever it is, I'll do it a damn sight better without you plucking about me like a doited hen.
Well, that's a nice thing to say, me having left my own housework to come over here.
It's the doctor's, Father.
Now, Anne, what's this? What's wrong with you now, Blue Eerie?
Well, that's for you to find out. What the hell do you think you're paid for?
There's nothing the matter with him except ill temper, and he's plenty of that.
Damned quine, you've nothing to do but stand about like a lady.
I'll get you some tea, Doctor.
It's taken a guy long time his examination, the doctor. Now, I never expected to be away as long as this. Chey'll be in from the field soon and wanting his meat. God knows what's happening at Peasy's Nap and me, know there.
I don't know either what's happening at Peasy's Nap. But if you're in such a tune about it, you'd better go home and find out.
Well, that's no way for a quine to speak to a woman that's old enough to be her mother.
I'm sorry.
You should think shame to curse and swear with your father lying up there at death's door.
I didn't swear, Mr. Strachan. And I'm over weary to argue.
It's bad, lass. Paralyzed.
Aye, that's what the doctor said. John Guthrie will never get out of his bed again.
What an awful thing to have happened.
He was aye that fleeting fast.
Aye, had a stroke, said the doctor. Kirsty was there when Chris was told.
Aye, I heard about that. They say the coarse quine started to curse and swear at your wife while her father was lying near dead upstairs.
Then they say lies. I asked Chris if she'd given the wife a bit of a damning and she said she hadn't. It's a pity, for it's high time somebody did.
Mind, I'm no surprise Blaweary had a stroke. No after that tink Will ran away.
Aye, I mind you said there would be a judgment on him.
It was his own rage that struck down John Guthrie.
True. Poor Chris.
What's the matter with you, quine? Have you gone deaf? Why don't you come when I call?
For 5 weeks, he lay there with a whistle beside his bed when he wanted attention. And that was often enough. 5 weeks of Chris do this and Chris do that. Half dead at night, I would find myself thinking a thing that wouldn't bear rethinking out in the sun. And Lord, if I could lie down for a day, how I'd sleep and sleep. Fold over my soul and my heart and put them away with their hours of vexing and caring. The ploughing was done and I was set to my drilling. And faith, it was weary work. But a worse thing came as that slow September dragged to its end. Thing I would never tell a soul. Festering away in the closet of my mind,
the memory would lie until it died. The memory of John Guthrie lying there with the harvest in his blood.
Chris. Come to me, Chris. Chris. Come to me, lass. Like they did in Old Testament times. You're my flesh and blood. I can do with you as I will. Chris. Come to me. Do you hear?
Frightened and quivering, I slipped from his room and took to locking my door at night. It was a wild fear. Seeing Father somehow struggling from his bed and coming down on me while I slept. That madness and tenderness in his eyes.
Farewell,
so I slept
adieu,
but little at night.
You Spanish lady.
Then one morning, I heard Long Rob singing. And that singing was sweet to hear. As though the world outside Blueary was singing to me, telling me that this thing in the still, dark house could never go on. No more than a chance and an accident it was. Wind-loved world of men. He was dead at last. Gone. With his gloomings and glarings. His whistlings and whisperings. Sleep. I could sleep as I chose now. Often and long. It was raining early in the dawn, that day of the funeral. A fine drizzle that seeped and seeped from the sky. So soft and fine that you'd think it snow without whiteness. There was no sun at first, but it came up at last and hung there like a red ball.
Just a little of the drama yourself.
You know,
say,
you know, Chris, a buddy would hardly think to look at you that your father was new dead. Wouldn't you now, Mrs. Munro? It's near 10. The minister should be here soon.
Aye, well, I've just been up and given your father's beard a bit comb. He looks fair decent lying there in his white shirt and tie.
It was kind of you, Mr. Strachan, to see to the funeral arrangements.
Aye, well, Chris is all young for this kind of thing. I must say she's taken it gay cool. I fear the speaker can rady her coolness.
Aye, I thought the same myself. You can, it's not quite decent for the Quine to be going to the funeral at all.
Well, it's different in this case, Whipple. We are having neither son nor brother to see him into the kirkyard.
Aye, how are you, lads? Aye, how are you? You need to come today. Aye, what's that?
We've been needing this if any more folk turn up. Maybe a cold walk to the kirkyard and a drop of Glenlivet will no do any harm.
Man, half a Kinradi's come to see Blaweary off.
Aye, it's more like a threshing day. I'm glad to see Cuddiston thought fit to put a white front over his working shirt.
Oh, Fishtrab, there's nothing wrong with a man. He seems decent enough to me.
Good shape.
At least you'll notice he's polished his boots.
Aye, good morning, Mr. Gibbon. Aye, aye. You'll take a...
Spirits, yes, thank you. I'll take a drop.
Aye, aye. Oh, you'll have a drama, Perel. You and your man, eh?
I hardly think it shows respect. And you and T.T. as well.
Aye. Oh, well, I'll just away and tell Chris you're here, Minister.
Aye. Tom, I was just saying to Chrissy that when she's sold up Leweary, she can come up and bide with us in the north.
Oh, aye, Chris. Some brave bit farmer would soon marry you up there.
We'll see. Uh-huh. I don't even know whether my father left a will yet.
Ah, well, there's no hurry to make up your mind, eh? I just come to tell you the minister's here.
Oh, well, the undertaker will not be far behind. Chris, would you like to see your father before they screw him down?
Well, goodbye, Blaweary man. He was a good neighbor.
Just screw it down now. Kiss your father, Chris.
Chris. Come to me, Chris. You're my flesh and blood. I can do with you what I will. Come to me, Chris.
Goodbye, Father. Jay stepped easily and cannily. But I walked free and uncaring, lifting my face to the wet September air and the world that was free to me. Then I saw it was Ewan Tavendale that walked beside me. He glanced down just then, and I looked up into his eyes. I looked, and near stumbled in the slow walk because of that looking. Still held off, and the wind soughing down the how died away. The sun glinted through from high up in the hill peaks, from up in the lost coarse ground where never a soul lived or passed, but maybe some shepherds. You could see them far off, lone and lonesome on a still clear day. Maybe so the dead walked in the coarse deserted lands of death, where only a chance wanderer showed his face, and the dead lapwings wheeled against another sun.
I am the resurrection and the life, saith the Lord. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die.
O death. And I listened to the words that promised resurrection and life through Jesus Christ our Lord, who had died long syne in Palestine and had risen on the third day,
and would take from that thing that had been John Guthrie quick, and was now John Guthrie dead, the quickness, and give it habitation again. I minded then all the fine things of him that the years had hidden. The unwearying fight he'd fought with the land and its masters to have us all clad and fed. I minded how he'd smiled at me and called me his lass in the days before the world's fight and the fight of his own flesh grew overbitter and poisoned his love to hate.
Earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. In sure and certain hope of the resurrection to eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ.
For the father I'd never helped and forgot to love.
Aye, well, Mr. Simple, I hope you had a good trip down from Stonehaven.
Oh, fair enough. I'm glad to see the weather's clearing, though. Yesterday was enough a day for a funeral.
Aye, it was that. There'll be a few bad calls in Kinraddy the day.
Did I? I met Chrissy Strip and go straight to bed as soon as she got back. I didn't want her to be the next in her grave.
And how's Christine taking it?
Oh, all? She cried all night. The lass must have been fair fond of her father.
Ah, he was fond of her.
You'll be referring to the...
I have it here just as he made it.
Aye, that would be after the boy went off to the Argentine.
Yes. I told your brother he was been fell sore in some of his family.
Ah, well, John Guthrie was a man that would never listen to advice.
Aye, told me to mind my own business, and that was a clerk's.
Oh, but he trusted you, Mr. Semple. And a man had to be fell straight in his gait before my brother would do that.
Here's a dram, Mr. Semple.
Oh, that would be most acceptable. Oh, thank you.
Ah, well, here's...
Well, now, Christine, I think we should get down to the business in hand.
Yeah, well, I think, Mr. Simple, if you could maybe just give us the gist of it first.
Oh, that's easy enough. It's as sharp and plain as you please. Your father wills that all his possessions in money and belongings go to you, Christine.
Everything?
Everything. The house without let nor condition. And the money amounts to over £300, which is in the bank.
£300, eh?
It's hard to believe that Father could have saved all that.
Aye, but he had. Now you'll be able to do as you planned, Christine. Get back to the college, and when you've passed your exams, take your degrees in Aberdeen and become a teacher.
What about Blueary?
Oh, the lease died with your father.
Oh, lass, you'll be well finished with a filthy sauce of a farm. Sell your gear and be done with it.
Ah, it's all very well, but if you ask me, John Guthrie's been gay, spiteful to his son.
Oh, it is possible that Will Guthrie might dispute the terms of the inheritance.
Well, that wasn't just what I meant.
Another thing, Christine. Your father has appointed me to be your guardian in such law matters as may need one. As to the goods and the gear, they're yours to control as you please. Now think well over it.
I'll do that. Now I had all that I wanted. But I felt no longer that fine thrill that had been with me while I made my secret plans. It was as though I had lost it down in Kinraddy Kirkyard. A knowledge came to me as I crossed Blueary's parks. Nothing endured. Nothing but the land I passed across. And I had thought to leave it all. My fine bit plannings. They'd been just the dreamings of a child over toys it lacked. Toys that would never content it when it heard the s'more of a storm, or the cry of sheep on the moors, or smelt the pringling smell of a new ploughed park under the drive of a coulter. Oh, I hated and loved that land in a breath. But my hate was no more than the fear of a child that cowered from the wind in the lithe of its mother's skirt.
Sit you down, Christine. This is fine and comfortable. And what brings Miss Guthrie up to St. Haven? Or you'll have been thinking about the will, no doubt.
Just that, Mr. Semple.
And what have you decided?
I'm going to live at Blueary for a while.
What's that?
I don't want to sell the gear. Not just yet. Maybe you could get the factor to renew the lease.
But you can't live there alone.
No. I was wondering if you could find me some woman. Some old buddy in need of a home.
There's plenty of them. But even
it mightn't be for more than a month or so. Just till I've made up my mind.
Just. A woman's mind. Just.
It's what I've decided, Mr. Semple.
I must advise you against it. Running a farm's no life for a young lassie. No life at all. Oh, this is the last thing I expected.
My father's will said I could do what I liked.
Aye. It did that. Well, I'll see what I can do with the factor. And there's an old widow buddy, Mistress Mellon, I'll send her down to Blaweary in the morning.
Thank you, Mr. Semple.
Aye. Well, you'll be going for the 11 o'clock train back to Kinraddy?
Haven't made up my mind yet. I thought I might take a look at the sea. Maybe have dinner in one of the hotels.
Oh, there'll be Guy busy at dinner time. Didn't forget it's market day.
Mind the time, then.
Look, Chris.
Hello, Ewan.
In for the day, then?
Oh, aye. Just that. You'll be in for the mark.
Aye.
I was just going up to the inn for dinner.
Maybe we can eat together.
Oh, maybe. What'll Mr. Gordon do?
Gordon can dance a jig at the head of the mart, for all I care.
He'll be in a fair rage.
Well, let him. I'm due a holiday today. I was working all last Sunday in a job living lambs.
Where'll we go, then?
Well, I know a place. It's got a nice room. We can have broth, oat cakes, boiled beef and turnips.
So you're in no hurry back?
Well, not unless you should be. What train are you taking back to Kinraddy?
No train in particular.
Well, maybe we can have the day together.
Aye. Maybe.
Maybe it's too soon after your father's funeral.
No. What'll we do?
Well, we can have our dinner first. Then, I know, we can walk out to the Nutter Castle.
And that was how it came about. The Nutter was in front of us, and we were climbing down the path that led to the island. Above us, the rock rose sheer, crowned with the ruins of the castle walls. Deafened by the clamor of the brutes. But quiet enough in the castle it proved. Not a soul seemed visiting there but ourselves. Down below in the dungeons, where the mouldering clefts where a prisoner's hands were nailed while they put him to the torment. There the covenanting folk had screamed and died while the gentry dined and danced in their lithe warm halls. I stared at the place, sick and angry and sad for those folk I could never help now. That hatred of rulers and gentry aflame in my heart. John Guthrie's hate. My folk and his they had been, whose names stood graved in tragedy. In this place died 9 persons, prisoners in Dunutter Castle, anno 1685, for their adherence to the word of God and Scotland's covenanted work of reformation.
Let's get out of this. Come down to the sea. I know a wee place. They say the rocks are hollow, and the water runs far below the fields. The ploughmen swear they can see their furrows quiver sometimes from the storm raging under their feet. Chris, do you like me a bit?
Can't fool you at all. That's why we're out here lazing in this place together. Like him? It was as though my blood ran so clear, and with such a fine, sweet song in my veins, that I must hold my breath to hear it. So it was that I knew I liked him. Loved him. Ewan?
Hmm?
Was it true? That story they told about you and old Sarah Sinclair?
Does it matter?
No. I'd just...
You just want to know for all that?
I don't want to know at all.
You'll damn well listen now that you've asked.
You're hurting my arm.
Aye, the Kinradi Craigs will say you were lucky if that's all the hurt you suffered from that coarse tink group you and Avondale. You might be thinking the same thing yourself.
I didn't mean anything like that.
I know fine what you meant. Aye, it's true about me and Sarah. It was the time of the year and we were both willing, especially her.
I don't want to hear about it.
Now you're frightened. Frightened that a woman should feel like that. Well, maybe one day you'll feel it yourself, Chris Guthrie.
Maybe I will, you and Tavendale. But when I do, I'll get a better man than you to serve me.
Chris! Come back! Chris!
That when they didn't have the men they wanted. I lay in bed that night and thought of Ewan, who was only a boy in spite of his Sarah Sinclair. I listened to the batter of the rain against my window and the swish of the great flow-weary trees. Auntie.
queuing up.
I must see to the beasts.
Oh, the cow will be all right unless the buyer's struck.
It's the horses I'm thinking of. Oh. Father put barbed wire around the field and he might draw the lightning. Oh. Uncle Tom! Uncle Tom, we must take in the horses!
Yeah. Oh, no, no, it's not safe outside in a night like that.
Oh, that's right, Chrissy. Best go back to your bed and wait till the morning, lass. Oh.
Storm seems to be moving to the south now, Chrissy.
Aye, it'll be light soon. And my name's Chris.
Damn it, Chris, is that all you adorn? You'll have caught your death, of course.
Oh, no, I'm all right. Shh.
Well, are your uncle and auntie still here?
Aye, they're away back to Auchterless tomorrow. Shut that window, you, and it's quite drafty.
The rain's brought out the smell of the honeysuckle. Fair drenches the air. Chris.
Kissing. Hey, Ewan, wait. Come down and see me tomorrow evening.
Chris, when will you marry me?
Whenever you say you want me to. But I'm so tired.
God damn it to hell, though, Chris.
See, you can't help it yourself.
It was you that started me.
Oh, we should waken them upstairs.
Tomorrow night, then.
Aye. I'll be waiting.
Good night, Chris.